Here's the sort of heating curve for a substance that you'd find in a typical physics or chemistry textbook. But how much of this curve are we able to actually reproduce in the classroom? In previous exhibition chemistries, we've looked at the heating gas part of the curve, and we've investigated supercooling in the formation of ice. Today, let's see if we can get the entire heating curve all the way from a solid up to a boiling liquid within a reasonable amount of time. We all have our go-to substances for a cooling curve experiment with our classes, but did you know that Cleeps had undertaken a survey of a number of different types of substance that actually might be found in the stock cupboard to see which ones work best? In L195, they have commentary and sample cooling curves collected from a range of candidates you might have in your cupboards, and potential pitfalls that the wrong choice or poorly managed practicals could open up. It's worth checking out though, because although I've never tried using naphthalene, it turns out it works out really well for this experiment. Now, a cooling curve of a liquid is only going to be able to show us two states of matter, obviously, and is also going to be complicated by the fact that the rate of cooling is going to be changing as the substance cools down. Now, if we were to go for a heating curve, that would allow us to supply some constant power to that system. And among the candidates that Cleeps have been looking at, we find 2-methylpropan-2-ol, also known as tert-butanol. Now, this substance has a melting point above that of room temperature, but boils below the temperature at which water boils. And that produces for us a possible way of actually very quickly going from a solid up to a boiling liquid in front of a class. Bob Worley suggested a couple of years ago that you can quickly demo three states of the same substance by placing a small amount of tert-butanol in the end of an ignition tube or past a pipette sealed at one end, in ice water first, and then freshly boiled water, watching it freeze and boil. Can we get good data from this though? Well, ideally such a demonstration would involve heating at a constant rate. It would see a plateau both for melting and for boiling, where the duration of the latter process should be significantly longer to demonstrate the difference between heat of vaporization and the heat of fusion. Create a curve in which students might be able to spot a difference between the rate of heating for the solid and the rate of heating for the liquid to reveal differing heat capacities of the different states, and complete the process in about 10 minutes. Now, one way of reasonably heating at a constant rate I've thought about was using the Cleeps microscale distillation kit, and that looks a little bit like this. There's a Make It Guide GL254, and essentially what we have here is a piece of copper, some wire that's wound around it, and that can be plugged into a classroom power supply. Unlike a boiling tube or a test tube, the form factor of a sample vial means that you don't need large amounts of the alcohol in order for shorter temperature probes to reach the substance. Although the instructions for the Cleeps microscale element suggest the use of a 7 cm cubed Bijou bottle, we found that the normal 30 cm cubed sample vials that we had around the department work pretty well as well. Now, in order for you to get your tert-butanol out of the bottle, it's likely to be frozen when you find it, you'll need to melt it. So to do this, you're going to loosen the lid slightly, place in a plastic bag to avoid ruining the label, and leave the bottle in some warm water. I advise working with a fresh sample of the tert-butanol every time you do this demonstration. You'll find that over multiple demo cycles, it will absorb moisture from the atmosphere and melt over an increasingly wide range, which kind of ruins the effect. One obstacle that you will also encounter with this demo potentially is if you freeze a probe into the substance, you might find that when you start doing the demo, the outside part will begin to melt and the liquid will actually increase well above its melting temperature while the solid still remains stuck to the probe, and that can mess up your readings. So one way of getting around this is by furiously stirring, but another way that I found about getting around this is by using crushed solid. And that has a number of other advantages in terms of being able to quickly set up the demonstration, because you can actually freeze the substance really quickly without having to freeze the probe in place within that substance. To do this, you're going to fill the sample vial approximately two-thirds, that's 15 to 20 centimeter cubed, with your liquid. Pour the liquid into a resealable sandwich bag and leave in the freezer. Place a few anti-bumping granules in with the remains of the alcohol in the sample vial and place this in the fridge with the heating element. Working with that powdered solid rather than one large frozen lump allows the solid to be stirred as it melts, and this prevents those large pieces sticking to the probe and gives you a better resolution of that melting point. Within minutes, the alcohol will have frozen in the bag and it can be easily broken into fine powder by crushing the bag in your hand. You can then load the solid into the sample vial, a wide-necked funnel or a weighing boat can help deliver the solid neatly, and leave the vial, heating element, and thermometer in the fridge until ready to start the demonstration. Set up a classroom power supply capable of delivering 5 amps, the data logger, allowing for about 1,000 seconds of data collection, and a clamp stand ready to hold the thermometer. Ensure the room is well ventilated, remove the loaded vial and heating element from the fridge, loosely clamp the thermometer over, and wait for the temperature reading to stabilize before starting data collection. Turn on the power supply to deliver about 3 to 4 amps of DC. Loosen the clamp and start stirring the powder with the end of the probe for even heating. At around 23 Celsius, the solid will begin to melt, and from this point, you can clamp the thermometer in the liquid and add a small amount of cotton wool around the rim to minimize vapor loss to the room. The average slope when heating the solid should be steeper than that for the liquid being heated. This is due to the lower heat capacity of the solid than that of the liquid. Although students will be unlikely to have met entropy by the time that you're showing them heating and cooling curves, teachers will recognize the similarity in the units between entropy and heat capacity and may want to point out how the liquid can store more energy in different ways, freed from the constraints of the solid structure. After a few minutes of increasing temperature, the liquid will begin to boil at approximately 83 Celsius, and the temperature will plateau. Leave it boiling for long enough to establish that this part of the heating curve will continue for a substantially longer time than the melting requires. As melting leads to a relatively small change in interparticle separation compared to vaporization, it makes sense that the latter process would take more time if heating under constant power. Now, if you do have a little bit more time and you don't want to set up a heating apparatus like I've mentioned before, you can of course use a regular water bath on a hot plate. But what you will find, the price that you pay with this is that the larger thermal mass of the water means that it'll take a little bit longer to get this demonstration looking nice. You can try and sort of speed things up by starting off with some preheated water, but you'll find then that you'll blast through the melting point of the tert-butanol so quickly that you won't resolve a nice melting point. It's not easy to get beautiful heating curves all the way, and that makes it all the more rewarding when you are actually able to get one. And even if it doesn't work out perfectly every single time, you still have plenty of opportunities to discuss with class, get their brains engaged, and get them thinking about what was actually happening at the end of the probe that could have led for the curve to look slightly different than we were expecting. So if you did give this a try, do let us have a look at your curves. We'd love to see how you're getting on. Otherwise, I'll see you next time.